a good delivery, full of length. That's one for 6 runs. Very warm welcome. You're watching NewsX. I'm Ritanshu Bhattacharya. The Indian Premier League Season 10 extravaganza continues, and tonight we are going to discuss about match number 23 between Kolkata Knight Riders and the Gujarat Lions at the one and only historic Eden Gardens in the City of Joy. We will also be reviewing Hashim Amla's superb century and discussing a place for Test batsmen in T20s. And last but not the least, we will also review Mumbai Indians' journey of chases this edition, along with an analysis of the points table. NewsX brings you the cricket carnival as we discuss, analyze and bring everything from the world of IPL. Former Indian cricketer Ritendra Singh Sodhi joins us from Chandigarh, and also right now joining me is former Indian cricketer Sava Karim from Mumbai. We will have a very quick debate with both of them, but first, let's go across and focus on the man of our show today. South African batsman Hashim Amla defied his critics once again in a sublime manner to break free from the stereotypical mindset that T20 matches are not meant for test batsmen. Amla smashed a 60-ball unbeaten 104 to show his prowess for Kings XI Punjab against the Mumbai Indians. Amla gave a statement of intent that class is permanent and it's the art of finesse in all formats that counts. Amla scored the second century of this edition's IPL and dominated against a star-studded Mumbai lineup. After Kane Williamson's breezy 89 for Hyderabad, it was Amla's time to defy his critics and indicate that there is a place for batsmen of the longer formats as well in T20s. Let's go across now to Sava Karim, who's joining us. Sava, how would you rate Hashim Amla's sublime innings as one of the best ever in IPL history?
Well, in terms of class and finesse, yes, because for Hashim Amla to score at such a brisk pace is not an easy task. So the fact that he has worked hard in his game, the fact that he had to prove a point that even good test players, test batsmen can score runs in T20, it goes to show that he really had to work very hard on his game. He had to reinvent himself, and I've been saying this for some time now, that for test players to come good, they need to reinvent their game, they need to work on their areas, they need to work their own space, they have to choose the right spots, they have to target particular bowlers, only then you can go on to get a big score, the way Hashim Amla did yesterday.
Ritinder, with IPL games no longer and T20 games no longer being a rarity, or at least the spectacle as it used to be earlier, it's now dawning on cricketers that it's as serious as test matches, and ultimately the slam bang approach doesn't really work, and it's the proper temperament and technique which is as important as T20s as they are in test matches.
Look, Ritanshu, one fact is there that whether you are playing 2020 cricket, whether you are playing 50 over format, whether you are playing test cricket, you need to have good technique. And I always feel if you don't have good defense, you can't play attacking shots. Abbey de Villiers is a big example. Virat Kohli is a big example. Kings of 2020 cricket. But they are equally good when it comes to test cricket. I think same is the case with Hashim Amla. And how beautifully he has answered his critics. Because when IPL started, Kings XI Punjab didn't play Morgan. They didn't play Sean Marsh. They went for Hashim Amla. So there was lots of criticism, lots of voices happening. But yesterday, the knock he played, one of the best ever, has silenced all the cannons.
Indeed, Sava, Hashim Amla has answered his critics by stating that test players can shine in T20 also. Your thoughts on Amla's evolution?
Gives you a sense of fulfillment when you drive home a point that T20 cricket is, T20 batsmanship is not only about just watching the ball and hitting it through the line. It also means that you need to have the basic, your basics right. You need to adhere to some principles of batsmanship, which you learn while playing test cricket. And Hashim Amla is one of those cricketers who have been able to drive home that point. because at times when a test batsman gets into a T20 format, he tends to imitate other big hitters in T20 format. So it talks about his faith, that he stuck to his own ability, he had faith in his own ability and his skill, and that although he is a world-class test batsman, but even world-class test batsmen can always score runs in this shorter format also. So it's not only good for him, but for others who have done well as test players, as test batsmen, for them it is a big window of opportunity. That if you work hard in a game, if you're able to reinvent your game to some extent, you can always score runs in this T20 format also.
Indeed. Now, Ritinder, obviously the other key takeaway that arises now, that with people now taking T20 matches seriously, it's also important to pace out the innings and structure it properly. And that is where anchormen like Hashim Amla turn out to be critical. People who know the experience and know how to make the entire innings revolve around their batting.
Yeah, that's the key, Ritanshu, because we all have that myth in our mind that 2020 cricket is just about bang-bang, slamming sixes all over. It's about sensibility, it's about wisdom, that when to attack, when not to attack. 6 to 14 overs are very crucial. You got to look for singles, you got to look for odd boundaries, and then after 14, you can go slam-bang. So there, lots of planning is required, and you need players like Amla, Virat Kohli, Abbey de Villiers to really stabilize the innings. And that's the key, I think. If any batsman understands this, I'm sure he will be a big success when it comes to 2020 cricket.
Well, obviously, Hashim Amla's heroics was only one aspect of what happened yesterday, but it also needs to be said that his heroics did go in vain, because Mumbai Indians, for them, the chase continues. It's something that Rohit Sharma and company have instilled in the team's DNA. Mumbai scripted its fifth win on the trot, and interestingly, all of them have been one chasing. Rohit Sharma's team eclipsed Hashim Amla's stunt for Punjab to seal a mammoth 199 run target in just 15 and a half overs. Josh Buttler and an informed Nitish Rana lit up Indore with some mighty fireworks. Mumbai's confidence is on a high, and they can claim the bragging rights of becoming the new kings of chasing in T20. Is there any stopping Mumbai at the moment, or should teams now worry of batting first while facing Mumbai? Sabha, Mumbai won five games on the trot. All of them are now chasing. Are they now the kings of pursuit?
They are a champion side. They are a very well-balanced side. That is why, while it is putting up runs on the board or while chasing, they seem to be at the top of the game right now. So Mumbai Indians have been able to do so because of some great quality all-rounders. Pollard is there, and then the Pandya brothers. So you can never rule them out. Even if the asking rate goes up, so about 15 runs per over in the last three or four overs, they have the right kind of players who can set the platform, who can set the pattern, and then score heavily, score big, and finish the game quite easily in the end. So no wonder at this stage of the tournament, Mumbai Indians are looking extremely powerful. It's all due to the number of match winners they have in their squad.
Ditinder, do you see it as a coincidence that all of Mumbai's victories have been one chasing, or do you feel that it's a deliberate strategic decision which is played off, or do you think it's just plain luck and they're that good a time side that they can win whether they're chasing or batting first?
They are a very good side. If they are batting first also, I'm sure they will have the upper hand. At this moment, their juggernaut is unstoppable. They have a very good side. As Saba has just pointed out, they have Pandya brothers, they have Pollard, and they can chase any total, any asking rate. So I'm sure that the way Rohit Sharma has been marshalling his resources, it has been simply superlative. Harbhajan is bowling well. That is a very important aspect, because he can really come and put brakes on the scoring rate. So you need somebody like Harbhajan Singh to really perform well in every game. So at the moment, Mumbai Indians, they are firing all cylinders, and fingers crossed, I'm sure that they are at the moment favourites to win IPL.
Indeed, Sava, very interesting. Sava, do you agree with Ritinder's view that with the statement of intent shown by Mumbai, they are indeed the favourites now for this edition's IPL?
Sense of fearlessness, something that speaks highly of this youngster. One has always known that he is very promising, extremely talented, but this is the kind of platform a youngster needs to showcase his talent and his skill. And I think that's what Nitish Rana has done. So he brings so much to the table for Mumbai Indians, for for a youngster to confirm his position at number three, talks highly about his motivational skills, the way he has prepared for this tournament. I think before each and every game, there's a lot of visualization that goes behind what we see on the field. For Mumbai Indians, it's been a wonderful find. Nitish Rana coming in at number three and cementing his position in the 11 as well as at number three bodes really well for Mumbai Indians.
Indeed, of course, Sava there holding Nitish Rana to be one of the key factors as to why Mumbai is that invincible. Ritinder, do you agree with that view that one of the reasons why Mumbai is favourite is the fact that while they do have a lot of big stars, international and Indian, it's the domestic players like Nitish Rana are adding a much level needed reliability to the team, and knowing that even if the big guns go out cheaply, there's always a tested and a reliable reserve bench strength to back them up.
Yeah, Ritanshu, it is very important because you have some good players, foreign players, star attractions, but you need Indian recruits to fire, and that is an asset for any IPL team. And Mumbai Indians, they are firing because of Nitish Rana, who's doing so well, then Pandya brothers, they are firing all cylinders. So that's the key. If your Indian recruits can perform like this and become a match winner, then I'm sure that you have a different team altogether. And that is one reason the tag of slow starters in the previous IPLs, which was attached with Mumbai Indians, it has gone far away. Because Pandya brothers, they have been exceptional. Nitish Rana has been superlative, and I would like to congratulate his coach, Sanjay Bhartwaj. He has really worked on it, and I can assure you, this man is the man to be noted in the notebooks. He's cool like a cucumber, but as effective as a volcano.
Indeed. Now, Ritinder, I request you to stay on with us. Obviously, we have been discussing Mumbai as one of the favourites for the IPL Season 10 trophy, but where do they really stack up right now with compared to the rest of the rivals? Now, it's over now to my colleague Rakshita to get us the points table at roughly halfway stage of this year's IPL. Rakshita, it's over to you.
Well, absolutely, Ritan. Thank you for coming on to me. Well, here's the scenario that IPL 10 stands right now. Well, Mumbai, as we were discussing about the master of chasing as far as this IPL is concerned, Mumbai is here winning 5 matches on the trot. 6 matches, they've played 5, they've won. Openers have flipped for them, local heroes have flipped for them. Of course, as Ritanshu mentioned about the Pandya brothers, and even their bowling or batting, both have been quite consistent and also in tandem, and they have clicked as a unit. When coming on to the second spot, well, Kolkata, we've seen a trend over the years in every IPL, and Kolkata does very well at the beginning of every season. We'll, of course, hope that they continue with this. Race match is going to be very crucial as far as Kolkata is concerned, and they will be eyeing to replace Mumbai at the spot. Well, this will be the match against Gujarat today. If they win this match, they will be at the numero uno spot. Hyderabad, of course, they are the defending champions, winning 4 out of the 6 matches played up till now. They have lost 2 matches. They are 8 points equal to what Kolkata has earned up till now. Hyderabad, of course, have been relying very much on David Warner and also Kane Williamson. They are doing well, of course, are in competition with the top 2 teams. Delhi, well, we've seen Delhi not performing very badly in the last season, but this time they are struggling to click as a unit, having just won 2 out of the 5 matches played. They have to put their game together. They are not stepping up to the situation. Whenever the testing times have been coming in for any thriller match, Delhi has failed to put out a commendable performance. As far as Punjab is concerned, it has been dented by a plethora of injuries, winning only 2 out of 6 matches. Injuries have been there. They again, just like Delhi, are struggling to put their game together, be it in the department of bowling or batting. Bangalore there, of course, after Virat Kohli returned to the team, they have, of course, improved with the position. But the problem is that they are too dependent. The over-dependency on the duo of Gale and Kohli is actually hitting them very hard right now. As the season is coming to a crucial stage now, they cannot afford to just rely on 2 players, having just won 2 out of the 6 matches. They have to step up their game. Pune languishing at the second last spot here, winning 2 matches only out of 5. Pune, of course, MSD, the biggest factor in IPL, as we have seen ever since the IPL has begun. Ever since he has donned the Pune jersey, he has been misfiring. And otherwise, if we see again, injuries have stricken the team. They haven't clicked. They have very weak bowling.
Rakshita, thanks a lot for getting us that points table. While we keep that table on the graphics, Ritinder, going by that, it won't be a very far-fetched assumption to make that Mumbai and Kolkata obviously are the favourites to get into the playoff league. And it once again is no surprise because they are not just champion sides who have the past record having won multiple tournaments, but they're also very balanced sides here. So they clearly know how to deal with pressure. Sunrisers Hyderabad clearly seem to be also on course for a Final Four berth, and that obviously is no surprise given the defending champions. But it's a fight for that last spot, which really seems quite interesting, Ritin. It seems there are all the other five teams can't be ruled out for making that last stretch sprint to make it to the Final Four.
Yeah, Ritanshu, still a long way to go in the tournament, and we have seen tide changing in IPL rather sooner. You never know with RCB because they can really fire back. They are struggling at the moment. Hyderabad, they are right at the top. They are playing good cricket. Kings XI Punjab, you can never say about them. They can make a comeback. But then stage becomes really difficult because after a few games, it will be like you have to win all the games. And yes, we have seen a team winning all the games. We have seen Mumbai Indians doing that. They needed 6 out of 6 if you talk about previous IPLs, and they won all the 6 games. So you can never rule out anybody. And that is what the charm about IPL is.
Well, interesting. Now, we are now going to look at a match that's going to happen in a few minutes from now, which is obviously one of the table toppers, or at least somebody who wants to be the table topper once again. Kolkata Knight Riders, somebody which is languishing right at the bottom of the table, Gujarat Lions. That, as we told you, Team Kolkata is all set to return to the, try to return to the top of the table as they take on Gujarat Lions, who are at the absolute opposite end of the table here. And that is a big match that is going to happen at the City of Joy's iconic Eden Gardens now. Now, obviously, Kolkata thrashed Gujarat in the opening encounter, and that will give them confidence going into the tie. Meanwhile, Gujarat Lions have faltered badly and they lie at the bottom of the table. Suresh Raina and company will be seeking to change their fortunes and step up to the task, but they have an uphill one at that. The team needs to focus on the bowling, and batting against Kolkata's batsmen will be the biggest challenge. Let's go across now and listen in to some of the key reactions coming in from Yusuf Pathan, especially one of the key difference makers for Kolkata in the previous game.
जो मेरा खेलने का स्टाइल है जो अग्रेशन है जो अग्रेसिवली खेलता हूं मैं वो मैंने चेंज नहीं किया है लेकिन इतना है कि मुझे अभी नंबर्स ऑफ ओवर्स भी ज्यादा मिल रहा है 12 ओवर 14 ओवर ऐसा नंबर्स ऑफ ओवर भी खेलने को मिल रहा है तो वो देखते हुए ये चेंज किए कि अपना जो शॉट्स है जो अग्रेसिव क्रिकेट में खेला हूं वो उसको कंटिन्यू करते हुए लॉन्ग इनिंग खेलने को देख रहा हूं
Sabha, Kolkata aim to continue their magic at home. How valuable is the Eden Garden, Sudhir?
For KKR, Eden Garden is their home. It is their fortress. They get invaluable support from their fans who throng in large numbers to support their side. But Eden Gardens, if you look at the wicket, it has undergone a massive change. So a lot of credit to KKR, the way they are prepared. Generally, the Eden Garden wicket is on the slower side. But this time, one has figured out that Eden provides an excellent battle between bat and ball. The wicket provides favorable condition for pace bowlers. It is good for batting as well. So they need to change their plan, which they have done so well. And that is why KKR have emerged as one of the title contenders once again. It's all because of the way they have prepared before this this IPL tournament. Keeping in mind,
very few teams have been able to really make their home ground a bastion and a fortress. Rajasthan Royals obviously was one of the champion sides of that, but Kolkata seems to have really made Eden Gardens their favorite hunting ground.
Also, Ritanshu, because I agree that home advantage is always there, but then you got to play good cricket, and KKR is doing that so well. They have all the arsenal. They have Gautam Gambhir, Robin Dappa firing. They have Yusuf Pathan. They have Sunil Narayan, who can really put shackles on the batsmen. And I'm sure that this team looks very balanced. They have equally good batting lineup, very good fielding outfit, and the way they can put breaks on the scoring rate, their bowlers are really commendable. So I'm sure in today's game, it's very easy to predict. The favourites are KKR.
Absolutely. Now, Sabha, one of the ex-KKR players is Brendan McCullum, who is now a key player in Gujarat Lions. Can he be trusted to lead the batsmen to get the better of Kolkata's bowlers?
I will say that only McCullum has the quality and he has the ability to do well against KKR bowlers. Suresh Raina is another one who has to come good if Gujarat Lions have to regain their lost form. But at Eden Gardens, to beat KKR is extremely difficult because they have a very well-balanced side. They have Umesh Yadav and they have two or three good quality seamers. They have Trent Bolt, whom they didn't play in the last game. So they brought in Kuta Nile, who did very well. They have Chris Wokes, a very excellent all-rounder. And then they also have the bases covered by having some match-winning spinners. They have Kuldeep Yadav and Sunil Narayan. So it is a very difficult task for any team, leave aside Gujarat Lions, to go to Calcutta and to beat KKR at Eden Gardens. Because KKR is always very well prepared, whoever they play against at Eden Gardens. So Gujarat Lions, given their form this season, it will be extremely difficult for them to overcome this hurdle also.
But Ritin, if you would be the KKR strategist at this point, what would you apply? Now, clearly, they're almost assured of their place in the final four here, but there are crucial chinks in the armor that still remain exposed, especially their overseas pace bowling department here. Now, would you advise KKR to really to be a bit more experimental and try out other combinations and other players? I know they've already been quite experimental, but try out a bit more, especially against a weak team like Gujarat Lions. Or would you wait for them to first seal their place in the first four, preferably in the top two, before trying out any new combination?
Look, at this moment, it will be very dicey to try new combinations because now tournament has reached that stage where Gautam Gambhir knows that what his combination is, and trying different players will definitely put brakes on the momentum, and no team wants that. So I'm sure that he might go with the same 11 if he keeps up the momentum, if team keeps on winning. But if there is somebody who's not performing well, totally out of form, all of a sudden, then we can see the change. Else I see same 11 playing, and that is the right thought because we have seen so many teams winning the tournament playing with the same 11 all throughout.
All right, Ritinder and Sava Karim, thank you so much for joining us with your perspectives here. It's time for a short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
It's a good delivery, full of length. That's gone for six runs.